And so we didn't have a formal eulogy at the on Saturday at the funeral home. There was a beautiful slideshow there, but I feel like I need to at least say something for Luke and Restin. I don't know if it'll do them justice. Restin still might have hated it, but if it provides at least a little bit of comfort to one of their friends or loved ones, Restin was the type of person who would have endured such a thing if it was helpful for somebody else. And I know Luke would have, he would not have wanted people to be, he would, it would have hurt him to see all of us as sad as we are now, but we can't not be sad. There's a Luke shape hole in our lives. There's a Restin shape hole in our lives, and we can't not be sad about that. Before I go any further, I'm just gonna ask the Lord's blessing upon me as I try to hopefully provide some comfort to those who mourn, including myself. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I'm running on empty right now, emotionally, physically. I know so many of Luke's friends and family and loved ones are, and Restin's are going through similar difficulties and circumstances. But your word is promised. Blessed are those who mourn, because they will be comforted. I have faith in you that you will provide that blessing, and I'll believe that it is a blessing, even though the pain is so great. I pray that you would be with all those who are struggling through the anxiety and the just the pain of this loss, for those who maybe had not left on the best of terms with one or the other of them, for those who feel that pain in their own lives and other relationships, I pray that you would bring comfort and peace to all of us. Pray that in Jesus' name, the Holy Spirit. Amen. So, our lives aren't going to be the same again. This occurred on November 23rd, 2 days before Thanksgiving this year. 2 years from now, it will be Thanksgiving on November 23rd. And Thanksgiving is never going to be the same for any of us. I even in the grief that's gone through this, there I've found so many things to be thankful for. There are so many new people that I've met, some existing people from family, friends, church that have been a tremendous comfort to me. And I know that you multiply that times the many, many, many friends that Luke and Restin had. I'm sure I'm not, I hope I'm not alone in my thankfulness for those others who have ministered to me. It's kind of like after Jesus was crucified on Friday, on Saturday, the disciples were locked together, huddled in a room, in despair for fear of the religious authorities that were coming after them. They thought, poor Peter, his last earthly memory was denying Jesus and having him look him in the eye as he was doing it. It was a hard day. And in one sense, it will be that Saturday for the rest of our lives as it relates to Luke and Restin. That we're not going to see him again on this earth, but Sunday is coming. The disciples, even though Jesus had told them what was going to happen, they didn't get it. Even when Sunday first came, they didn't get it. So Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb. Jesus is gone. My Lord is gone. Where have you taken him? One of my favorite questions, one of the angels ask her, why do you seek the dead among the living? He is not here, for he is risen. It took a while for things to click. It may not have been until the day of Pentecost itself. So even after Jesus was risen and he spent 40 days with his disciples and explained and taught about all that he had come to do and accomplish, even on the day right before the ascension, they're like, well, are you gonna come and restore the kingdom of Israel? And thinking mostly in an earthly sense, they never ask that question again after Pentecost. They kind of get an idea that that Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. And they took that hope of Jesus to Jerusalem and Israel and Samaria, even to the ends of the earth. I don't know what Sunday is going to look like. I can speculate. I can hope. But I know that the person, the triune God, in three persons, is the one writing the story, and I trust in him. He has promised to make things right. He has promised to wipe away every tear, every single tear. I don't know how he's going to do it, but I have faith that he will. In situations like this, you have two choices. You have the way of blood and the way of redemption through Jesus Christ. And you're never going to consistently, thankfully, none of us consistently follow the way of blood, and regrettably, none of us consistently follow the way of redemption in the here and now. I want to relate a something that I said. I was looking for a diversion. My friend Rick is a democratic socialist. I am a libertarian anarchist, and he had a post that talked about socialism, and it kind of got divisive. These are the words I said to my friend. You are a coward. You should have to look at your neighbor in the eye and point the gun to his head yourself instead of hiding behind the skirts of a government agent. Zing. Congratulations, Mike. He said while hiding behind a keyboard himself, not recognizing the irony at the time. But how many of you have lashed out at somebody since this happened? Not even at those that you consider enemies, but at those who are your friends and your loved ones. Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. That's what the way of blood can kind of do. The way of blood wants vengeance. And you know what? We've got, it's never satisfied. The way of blood says, you killed 2,000 of my people in an attack. I'm gonna kill start a war and kill 1 million people who weren't responsible. The way of blood says, you're no son of mine, or says, you're dead to me. It leads to estrangement and pain. The way of blood says, oh yeah? Well, the jerk store called and they're running out of you. It's never as satisfying as you think it'll be. The way of blood says, if Cain was avenged sevenfold, I'll be avenged 77-fold. It says it takes, you're forgiven. There's a parable in the Bible, a servant who is forgiven $1 billion debt, kind of in today's terms, and then turned around and choked another servant who owed him a quarter. You can take the way of blood not just with others, but with yourself. God can never forgive me of insert wrong here. I'm worthless. I'm hopeless. I'm too far gone. The way of blood is never satisfied. People might think, like in the Old Testament, the provision, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, life for life, blood for blood. It seems harsh today. It seems harsh today because the world has been changed by Jesus Christ. The way of blood doesn't say an eye for an eye, it says a head for an eye. It doesn't say a life for a life, it says 70 lives for a life or 1 million lives for a life. Revenge, guilt, anger, those things are never, you give in to them and they're never satisfied. But there's a person who came into this earth, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, and lived a sinless life, died for the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And there is a way of redemption through him. The way of redemption says, I'll remove your sins as far as east is from west. I'll forgive you 77-fold. So Lamech says, I'll be avenged 77-fold. Peter asks Jesus, how many times, how do you forgive? You forgive 77-fold. I won't hold your past transgressions against you. It's said about Jesus, the Prince of Peace, a bruised reed he will not break, a smoldering wick he will not quench. And because he first loved us, you can have something like love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Do not repay evil with evil, but overcome evil with good. The way of redemption says, that poor other driver. So part of, and I feel bad, I didn't really come around to this until Saturday morning right before I left for the funeral. And I'd like to read an email I think I might have found. So Thomas Nix is the other driver. And if Luke had a lot of friends, Restin had a lot of friends, maybe there's a mutual connection. Charlotte's a fairly, can be a fairly small place sometimes. And so maybe somebody can get this video into his hands. I think I might have found an email that belonged to him, but I don't know. Like, he's deleted a lot of his social media profiles. So Thomas, I'm going to read this in case you never see the email. It's, I don't know if I'll make it through it, but I can try. Hi, Thomas. I don't know if you'll ever see this, or if you're even the right Thomas Nix. My name is Mike Dushman. I'm married to Luke's sister, Shelley. I was with Luke and Restin at trivia at the Flying Saucer in Charlotte on Tuesday, November 23rd. We had done this most Tuesdays for the past couple of years. Our team name was boldly going nowhere. Luke and Restin love Star Trek. That night I recall so much focus on the future. Restin was studying for an upcoming test. Luke was fussing at Restin because he wasn't allowed to buy anything for himself because Christmas is coming. They were planning a trip for February of next year with Luke's sister Erin. They were lamenting about being in a tiny house because they had sold their house and were planning on building their dream home. That future is gone. Less than 10 minutes before they died, I told them goodbye and see you on Thursday. I didn't know then that it was going to be the last goodbye. If I did, I would have hugged them and I wouldn't have let go. I had been blessed in my 41 years on this earth with a minimal amount of grief. If you take the previous worst grief in my life and multiply it by 10, it doesn't even touch this. I'm absolutely devastated. I know that this has been extremely hard for you. I can't imagine the regret. I don't need to beat you up, because I know that you're going to be far harsher on yourself than even the most malicious message you've received from Luke's and Restin's loved ones. I've never even been mad at you, but I confess that I haven't prayed for you nearly enough. Nobody can carry the burden you are carrying without breaking. After their initial anger and grief, Restin probably would have taken a little longer to come around than Luke. Their attention would have turned to that poor other driver. That's the type of people they were, and that's the type of person I need to be. I don't know your religious background. If you don't know Jesus, I hope that I can be an ambassador of his love and grace and truth. Why did God take Luke and Restin and leave you alive? There's a pretty good chance this question has crossed your mind. I don't know the answer, but I trust and believe in the God who does. He has promised to work all things together for the good of those who love him. He has promised to make things right and wipe away every tear, every single tear. He will make things right. I don't know how he's going to do it, but I know who he is. He doesn't make mistakes. He left you alive for a reason. I'm a deacon candidate at Holy Trinity Reformed Church in Concord. We meet at 3747 Trinity Church Road in Concord every Sunday at 11 a.m. The door is always open. Some Sundays, I have the privilege of serving Holy Communion. I hope and I pray that on some Sunday in the future, that I will be able to look you in the eye and say, the body of Christ was given for you, and the blood of Christ was shed for you. I know it's going to be hard to walk through those doors. It will take courage. It will be uncomfortable. But you know what? There were a couple of times when Luke and Restin walked through those doors together. I ask that you emulate their courage. Let me know when any of the legal proceedings take place. I would like to come and ask that the state of North Carolina have mercy on you, just as God in Christ has had mercy on me. Sincerely, Mike Dushman. It's hard to get through that. Reading it, it was hard to get through that, writing it. But it's the only way that you'll get true healing out of this. It's the only way I'll get true healing out of this. Thomas, it's the only way you'll get true healing out of this. And this brings me back to Advent. So I talked about how Thanksgiving, our lives will never be the same, and Thanksgiving will never be the same. And Luke and Restin's deaths happened on the Advent of Advent, right before it started. And while Advent will never be the same for us, I think it might never be the same, at least for me, in a good way. I now, at a visceral level, understand that longing and groaning for things to be made right, for that light of the world that the darkness will not overcome. Our family went to Myrtle Beach for vacation the week before this happened. And I don't know why, but I stood outside on our balcony and I watched the sunset I continued to watch the sky after the sunset. It was beautiful. The day fought hard against the darkness. Long after the sunset, you could see a rainbow spectrum coming up from the horizon, from the red, even a little tiny bit of green, to the violet, and then finally to the darkness of night. And the day lost that day. It fought hard, it fought beautifully, but the night came. Right now, we're walking through that valley of the shadow of death, and that shadow's pretty dark right now. But there will come a day when that darkness is going to try to come, and the day's going to fight, and the darkness isn't going to overcome the light. Jesus came as the light of the world to redeem, not to condemn. Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. The Son of Man came not to serve, not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. That, maybe I should just stop. I'm kind of rambling, but there's a old hymn, and I'll end with this, that ends, "Even so, Lord Jesus, quickly come, and night shall be no more." I look forward in faith to the day when that will come. I'll close in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your grace and mercy toward me. I thank you that you come to make your blessings flow far as the curse is found. I thank you for the work that has already been done to reverse that curse. I thank you that you are building your church and that the gates of hell will not stand against it. I thank you for dying for me. I thank you that the grave could not hold you. I don't know how you're going to make things right, but I know that you are. And I'm thankful that you love, that I'm able to love because you first loved me. Amen. Rest in peace, Restin. Rest in peace, Luke. God bless you, everyone.